Hello and welcome to the talk on systematization of algorithmic incentive manipulation attacks on permissionless proof-of-work cryptocurrencies. This talk is based on an SOK paper which was a joint work between all of the authors and which also profited a lot from a lot of discussions at two different Dachstuhl seminars. My name is Alyosha Jutmeier, I'm this guy here, and without further ado, let's directly dive into the topic. I want to start this talk with a quote some of you may know, and this is as follows. The system is secure as long as honest nodes collectively control more CPU power than any cooperating group of attacker nodes. This quote, of course, is from the original Bitcoin white paper by Satoshi Nakamoto. And in this talk, I want to emphasize one word of this quote, namely honest. The key element all bribery and incentive manipulation attacks have in common is that they all do not only differentiate between honest and Byzantine nodes, but they assume that a substantial portion of nodes acts rational. And immediately the question occurs, what happens to this statement if we replace honest with rational? And the way to answer or to approach this question is to the first step in the direction is to better be able to compare existing attacks in this space to each other. This is a list of early discussions and publications in the area of bribery and incentive manipulation attacks. To the best of our knowledge, the first mentions of bribery attacks date back to a Bitcoin forum user to a Bitcoin forum post by a user called Kunikula. And the first peer-reviewed publication was from 2016 by Joseph Bonneau. It's called Why Buy When You Can Rent. And also a lot of other attacks have been proposed since then. Most of these attacks go by the name of bribing or bribery attacks, but there are also some that are called exclusion or censorship attacks. There are some that go under the name of goldfinger attacks or denial of service attacks. And there are also front-running attacks. And all of these attacks obviously have some common elements related to incentives, but as you see from the attacks, they not only have vastly different goals, they also can have vastly different system models. So there's a desperate need for for a classification framework to better compare these attacks to each other, so that I not look like this guy here when I try to explain these attacks to you. And of course, we do not have time to explain or go over all these attacks in detail. So what I will first do is start with some attacks and show you how the general mechanics of bribing attacks work, and then also highlight to you how and why these attacks can be so different. Let's start with a classic bribing attack. For now, we assume we want to attack Bitcoin, and this is a Bitcoin block, and these are the associated transactions with this block. We now want to double spend the transaction T and use bribing attacks to aid the double spend. As in traditional double spend, we have to wait a couple of confirmation blocks until the merchant considers this transaction T here confirmed. For the sake of simplicity and to spare me a few drawing of blocks, let's just assume this confirmation block number required is 1. Now, a new block is generated with the conflicting transaction T prime, and so far there is nothing new to a traditional double spend. Now the attacker wants, of course, that his chain containing the double spend becomes the longest chain. And if the attacker now uses bribing to aid the attack, he can create a new block, or basically he can create a new transaction B1 containing bribe number 1, which is an anybody can spend transaction, so basically which is free money for the miner who will mine this block containing this transaction B1. And if this transaction B1 here is in the mempool, he additionally incentivizes miner to pick up this transaction as an additional income stream for mining this block. And if this bribe here is sufficiently large, it might be more profitable or even worth risking mining this block here for a miner than to extend the longest chain as usual. So if miners now follow the bribe They will mine here at the next block. And of course, this attack can be continued. So here's another transaction, B2. And this transaction also carries a bribe. And it's at that point already, this chain is longer than the original chain. And therefore, the double spending attack was successful. And also, the sending or the offering of further bribes can be stopped now by the attacker. There are different variants of this kind of attack. Of course, you can also imagine an attack where not the attacker itself has to mine this initial block here, but instead just offers a transaction B1 already carrying a large enough bribe or anyone can spend transaction that already depends on this transaction that ought to be double spent T prime. Depending how this is done, for example, it can be done with check lock time primes, as mentioned in Joseph Bonneau's paper, why I buy when you can rent, or it can be done with transactions that carry a large fee, which is done in the whale transaction attack. The next attack we want to look at is the BDoS attack, a blockchain denial of service attack. We again assume that the target blockchain is Bitcoin, but this time the goals of the attacker are quite different than in our previous example. Now the attacker wants to grind the blockchain to a halt. And therefore he tries to find a new block and he just publishes the block header but not the list of associated transactions. Thereby the whole block cannot be verified by other miners. Only the block header and the associated valid proof of work works as some kind of proof that there is a next block that has been found, but does not provide the possibility for other miners to fully verify this block, if it's valid or not. So miners now face the decision, if they build up on a block header without knowing the transaction associated, so basically they could just include transaction either they know they are valid or no transactions. This would be the same situation like in spy mining or SPV mining. Or alternatively, miners can decide to not build up on this block and basically fork and create their own block as usual and publish this as usual. So this forking situation bears the problem that the miner who originally mined this red block here can decide to immediately publish this red block with all its associated transactions as soon as he sees a competing block mined by another miner and immediately creates a tie and therefore a race between those two chains. And in the worst case, the miner who tried to fork this red block here ends up on the smaller chain and therefore gets forked away. So in both situations, the situation for other miners is not optimal. In the first case, miners know that there might exist another block, but they cannot build up on it because they have to fear that the list of associated transactions will never be published. And in the other case, if they fork it away, they can be sure that they immediately might provoke a tie. So in the paper BDoS, they analyzed the situation and came to the result basically that it would be the best for the miner to pause mining and therefore the attacker would gain his goal of grinding a blockchain to a halt. Note that in this situation, although incentives clearly are involved, no bribe is explicitly paid. Either a credible threat in form of a block that is proven to be there but not being able to verify is created to induce the desired effects. The next attack we want to have a look at is the Goldfinger attack. The Goldfinger attack was originally proposed by Kroll et al. In this paper here, and it's named after the James Bond movie villain Auric Goldfinger, which tries to destroy all the gold reserves in Fort Knox to increase the value of his own holdings. The first practical instantiation of a Goldfinger attack was proposed by McCurry et al. In this paper here, which utilizes Ethereum and smart contracts to instantiate the Goldfinger attack on Bitcoin. So in our example, we again have Bitcoin as a target cryptocurrency, which progresses as usual. And now we also have Ethereum as a funding or orchestration cryptocurrency, that basically orchestrates the attack on Bitcoin. Therefore, an attacker publishes a contract on Ethereum, and this contract is configured to reward a miner for mining an empty Bitcoin block. And this reward, of course, must be higher than what a miner would gain for normal full Bitcoin block together with fees. So now, basically, miners in Bitcoin face the decision to either mine an empty Bitcoin block, which they think can later or send to the contract in Ethereum and get a higher reward, or mine a normal Bitcoin block for which they would get less reward. If now a miner finds such an empty block, he can send it to the Ethereum contract, and the Ethereum contract would then later pay out the associated reward. And of course, the attacker can immediately take this block header and this one associated transaction, the Coinbase transaction, and forward it to the Bitcoin chain. And because the verification of a valid Bitcoin block hash, or which fulfills the proof of work target, and the verification if there's only one transaction, which is the Coinbase in the block, can be done in the smart contract. So in that case, the smart contract acts as an intermediary between the briber and the bribee, so that both parties get the desired results. On the one hand, empty blocks, and on the other hand, guaranteed payment for these empty blocks. If the attack is successful, the value of Bitcoin is diminished because no further transactions can be included in the Bitcoin chain as long as the attack contract on Ethereum is sufficiently funded. So what we've seen from the attacks we looked at so far is that they indeed can all be very different. But what all these attacks have in common is that all of these attacks manipulate incentives. So all of these attacks can be summarized under the term incentive manipulation. But because also walking up to a miner with a suitcase full of gold and physically bribing this miner would classify as incentive manipulation, we further want to distinguish these attacks by using the term algorithmic incentive manipulation. This should emphasize that all these attacks use algorithmic or programmatic means in terms of conditions, smart contracts, or provable credible threats to algorithmically manipulate the incentives of participants. So a broad definition could be as follows. Algorithmic incentive manipulation utilizes either credible threats or conditioned rewards denominated in cryptocurrency units to incentivize certain actions within the targeted cryptocurrency system to be taken by capable actors. So, as we've seen, the manipulation of incentives can either come in form of threats or in form of rewards. And the cryptocurrency system can either be targeted from within it, or there can be another cryptocurrency that works as a funding cryptocurrency. And what does the term capable actor mean? Well, in context of proof-of-work cryptocurrencies, a capable actor would be a miner, but the miner does not necessarily have to be within the cryptocurrency as long as he is capable of providing proof-of-work for the required algorithm. In case of proof-of-stake, a capable actor might be an actor who is in the possession of voting stake. So now we have a definition and know what we are talking about, we can go on and try to find a general attack model for algorithmic incentive manipulation attacks. Therefore, we want to explicitly concentrate on proof-of-work cryptocurrencies, as all attacks proposed so far explicitly target these types of cryptocurrencies. So also in our attack model, we differentiate between Byzantine miners, altruistic miners, rational miners, and victims. The Byzantine miners are basically the attackers. They might have some hash rate, but they might also not have some hash rate. What they have in any case are funds. Altruistic miners, to the contrary, are the honest guys basically. They follow the protocol rules no matter what, even if they would earn higher rewards without doing so. These altruistic miners might have some hash rate, but there also might be cases where there are no altruistic miners and all miners are rational. Rational miners are basically the bribable miners. These miners want to maximize their short-term profits no matter what. So in any case, in algorithmic incentive manipulation attacks on proof-of-work cryptocurrencies, there are rational miners. We also further distinguish explicitly between victims. So in most attacks, victims are not directly defined, but we explicitly define them as the victims of, for example, a double spending attack, and in this case, victims are not assumed to have any hash rate. So now that we have defined our actors, we now define our classification frameworks along four main characteristics, before then providing some examples of how we apply this classification framework to existing attacks. These four main characteristics are the state of the targeted transactions, the intended impact on these transactions, and the required interference with consensus to gather the intended impact on the transactions. And four, the used payment method. So let's take a closer look at each of these dimensions. Let's start with the state of targeted transactions. Here, there is not much new compared to previous works. We differentiate between unconfirmed, confirmed, and settled transactions. An unconfirmed transaction, also known as broad proposed or published transactions, is basically a transaction that was broadcasted in the peer-to-peer network and only exists in the mempool so far. A confirmed transaction is a transaction that is confirmed or included in at least one block, therefore buried at least one block deep in the blockchain. A settled transaction is a transaction that is confirmed by at least k blocks, where k is a security parameter defined by the recipient. So note that there is no global security parameter k. And for example, if we want to denote the k that is chosen by the victim, we write k subscript v. Our next dimension is the intended impact on transactions. Here we differentiate between transaction revision, which was basically revising a transaction or replacing a transaction with another version, conflicting version. This was for example, required in a classical double spend. And the targeted transaction can either be unconfirmed. This would be the case, for example, in replace by fee, or it can be confirmed or settled. The other category is transaction exclusion, or also known as censorship, and this basically refers to keeping a transaction unconfirmed for a bounded amount of blocks. Another intended impact would be transaction ordering, so reorder the transactions, and this refers to changing the proposed, confirmed, or settled ordering of transactions. And the last intended impact would be the triggering of transactions. So this would mean that the creation of one or multiple new transactions is incentivized by the attack. We will see that this indirectly happens in some of the attacks as a byproduct, as transactions are necessarily required to handle the bribes. The next dimension is the interference with consensus. Here we differentiate between deep fork, near fork, no fork. If a deep fork is required, like for example in a classical double spend, this means that a fork of length L greater than the security parameter defined by the victim, KV, is required. If a near fork is required, this means that the length of the fork, so the depth, is not dependent on the security parameter KV chosen by the victim. So this would, for example, be the case in transaction exclusion or censorship attacks, where one fork is added to the blockchain that includes the specific transaction. And a no-fork or no-fork would be required if there is no blockchain reorganization required at all, so the length of the required fork is zero. This would be the case, for example, in most front-running attacks. The last dimension we want to look at in this talk is the used payment method. Here we differentiate between in-band payment, out-of-band payment, and threat. In an in-band payment, the bribe is paid as a transaction within the targeted cryptocurrency. In an out-of-band payment, the bribe is paid in another cryptocurrency, so-called funding cryptocurrency. This was the case, for example, in the Goldfinger contract described previously. And if no payment or direct payment or bribe is paid out, there might be the category of a threat. This was the case, for example, in the BDoS example. So there is no direct payment happening, but a credible threat is constructed that non-compliance will lead to losses. So now let's use the classification framework to compare some algorithmic incentive manipulation attacks. Let's start with the check lockdown primes and the whale transaction attack we've briefly discussed previously. Those attacks are very similar. They both aim at transaction revision, which means they are aimed to revise previously settled transactions, like for example in a double spend. And if the amount that is double spent is higher than the paid out bribes, these attacks can be issued in a profit, can be executed in a profitable way. The difference between those attacks, despite the underlying functionality, are only subtle. Like for example, the whale attacks are only defined for attackers which also have hash rate, but as previously said, they also could be imagined in a way where the attacker is not required to have any hash rate. The other subtle difference is that checked lockdown bribes trigger transactions, namely when the anyone can spend output are claimed by the miners, while whale transactions, at least in theory, would not require any additional transactions to claim output, as normal transactions can be used, or the access fee of normal transaction can be used to issue the bribes. Let's look at front-running attacks now. So front-running attacks explicitly target transaction ordering of unconfirmed transactions. So they do not require any fork in the best case, and the payment usually is in-band by the fee of the transaction. And they might trigger additional transactions, namely when they replace previous transactions with ones with higher fee. The BDoS and the Goldfinger con are both attacks that target the blockchain, so basically they target all or almost all transactions, and they want to exclude them so that the blockchain or the underlying cryptocurrency is not operational anymore. The major difference between those two attacks is that the BDoS does not explicitly pay out bribes, but the BDoS creates a credible threat to fear away miners. And the Goldfinger con creates out-of-band, or basically issues out-of-band payments to incentivize empty block creation. So this is also why the BDoS attack requires hash rate, and the Goldfinger con attack does not require any hash rate in the target cryptocurrency. One attack that achieves a lot of which is transaction revision, ordering, exclusion, and does also not require any attacker hash rate, are the pay-to-win attacks, so explicitly the pay-to-win revision, exclusion, and ordering attack. And this is a shameless plug, because this attack will be discussed in the next talk in this session. So stay tuned for more. I want to use the remaining time of this talk to discuss costs, profit, and direction for future work. Costs and profits of algorithmic incentive manipulation attacks are really difficult to compare, not only because of the different system models and different goals of attacks, reaching from profit-oriented attacks to Goldfinger attacks that aim to destroy a certain currency. No, it's also difficult because the costs are not always analyzed in a comparable way. For example, sometimes they are given in terms of hash rate, sometimes they are given as absolute costs, and sometimes only operational costs are provided. So, to derive the profit of an algorithmic incentive manipulation attack, it's necessary to somehow define the extractable value of an attack. In this context, front-running, the term minor extractable value was coined. And it basically refers to the value that can be extracted by a miner from including a certain transaction, like, for example, the fees associated with the transaction or a guaranteed profit from arbitrage. With algorithmic incentive manipulation, though, it can be argued that the extractable value of a transaction cannot readily be determined by just looking at the transaction in the cryptocurrency where this transaction is to be performed, because there might be other attacks going on in other cryptocurrencies influencing the extractable value of this particular transaction. Moreover, there might not be one minor extractable value, but plenty of extractable values also from users at play at the same point in time, and these extractable values might even influence each other. So all these complexities aside, a really simplified equation for determining the profit of algorithmic incentive manipulation attacks from the perspective of one actor could be derived from a formula given by Böhme in 7. So this would be that the extractable value of an algorithmic incentive manipulation attack minus the costs of the attack must be greater than the extractable value of the alternative, like, for example, following the protocol minus the costs of following this protocol. If this is true, then the attack is profitable. So this talk and the associated systematization of knowledge paper was, of course, just the first step into exploring the delicate roles of incentives in permissionless cryptocurrencies. There is a lot of room for discussions and future work. Like, for example, the concept of mitigations. A lot of the papers covered in the systematization have a very attack-centric view, and therefore there is not much room for counterattacks and discussing mitigations. So this topic deserves further analysis. Also, the concept of rationality and how rationality is defined in context of permissionless cryptocurrencies is very relevant to assess the practicality of certain attacks. So, are they likely to happen in practice? Are they just theoretically? Will we see them in future in cryptocurrencies? Don't know. Also, the situation for other proof systems like proof of stake is not conclusive at the moment. So, there is a lot of room for future research and also future work. Thank you for your time, and maybe we see you also in the next talk on this session.